today, the topic of my presentation is status epilepticus. Before I start the presentation, I would like to say that I have no conflict of interest in regards to this presentation. I will talk about the definition of a status epilepticus, etiology, pathophysiology, systemic manifestation, its management, and neuroprotective measures. So in old era, the status was defined as convulsive seizures lasting longer than 30 minutes or convulsive seizure lasting for more than 15 minutes. Or the seizures, serial seizures between which incomplete restoration of consciousness. Currently, the status is defined as a single unremitting seizures lasting more than 5 minutes or two or more discrete seizures in which there is incomplete recovery of consciousness. So any child who is brought in the emergency room with seizures should be treated as a status epilepticus regardless of the prior duration. So the the Epilepsy Society in 2015 defined status as a condition resulting either from the failure of the mechanisms responsible for seizure termination or from the initiation of mechanism that lead to abnormally prolonged seizures after the time point T1, or a condition that can change, that can have long-term consequences like neuronal death, neuronal injury, and alteration of the neuronal network depending on the type of and duration of seizures. So T1 and T2 are defined as 5 minutes or 30 minutes. So the 5 minutes are time during which the treatment should be initiated. So status can be classified as convulsive and non-convulsive. The convulsive includes generalized convulsive, focal motor, myoclonic, and the non-convulsive include absence seizures, complex partial seizures, and non-convulsive seizures, status epilepticus with coma. So there is a terminology of refractory status epilepticus that is defined as the seizures that fail to remit despite of the treatment with adequate doses of anticonvulsants. Or this refractory status epilepticus developed in 30 to 40% of the adults and is associated with greater mortality. In children, 10 to 40% of the status become refractory. Mortality for the pediatric refractory status is 13 to 30%, and 33 to 50% of the patients have neurological consequences. Super refractory status is defined as the persistence or recurrence of seizure despite of at least 24 hours of pharmacologic coma, including the occurrence of breakthrough seizures during tapering of anesthetic medications. It may occur in patients with severe brain injury or those who are previously healthy with no apparent cause of status. So there are various etiology, among which febrile or acute symptomatic etiologies are the more common in children and account for more than 80% of the status among children less than 2 years of the age. The etiologies are classified as cryptogenic that account for 15% of the patient and is defined as the absence of an acute precipitating central nervous system disease or metabolic dysfunction in a patient without any pre-existing abnormality. The remote symptomatic status account for 24 to 28% and it includes a patient with a known history of neurological insult. Febrile, that is the most common, account for 30 to 50%. And acute symptomatic status epilepticus during an acute illness can be associated with meningitis, traumatic brain injury, or hypoxia. And metabolic dysfunction like hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, hyponatremia can also cause status epilepticus. Progressive encephalopathies include neurodegenerative disorders and account for 1 to 5% of the diseases. It also includes malignancies and some chronic conditions. So basically, the pathophysiology is associated with the failure of the GABA-mediated inhibition and increase in glutamate-mediated excitation. So this is the seizure model. And the seizure and showed that how the seizures are usually initiated. The seizure begins with an intrinsically firing neuron facilitated by the inadequate inhibition recruit adjacent neurons. As the adjacent neurons begin firing, excitative mediators are released like glutamate, and this glutamate then activate the NMDA receptors and facilitate the local neuronal synchronization as well as seizure spread. Beside this, the GABA receptors are downregulated and NMDA receptors are upregulated that further promote the spread of seizures. Seizure-induced alteration of GABA and glutamate activity facilitate the seizures continuation and spread. Now, the mechanism implicated in seizure termination include predominance of GABA activity, membrane stabilization of acidic extracellular pH mechanism, magnesium blockage of NMDA, receptors and activation of sodium potassium ATPase pump and activation of potassium conductance to allow the membrane repolarization. So what happened with the brain, basically there is excessive glutamate activate the NMDA receptors causing excessive calcium influx with the resultant activation of the intracellular proteases, nitric oxide production, free radical generation, and it produces oxidative stress in the cells resulting in cell death. And the cells that do not die, they have elevated intracellular calcium and alter the calcium dependent second messenger effect, including neurogenesis, axonal sprouting, protein expressions, gene regulation, or receptor gated ion channels recycling. So these alterations promote the development of epilepsy in future and also result in cognitive deficit after status epilepticus. So seizure increase the glucose metabolism and intracranial pressure, placing the vulnerable cerebral tissue at greater risk for the injury. So these are the clinical manifestation, and there are two phases. Basically, during the early status epilepticus, the compensatory mechanisms are predominant, and they include increased catecholamine surge, increased cardiac output, increased cerebral blood flow, etc. And there's a transition from early to late status epilepticus occur after 30 to 40 minutes of continuous seizure activity. And the late phase is marked by failure of compensatory mechanisms. So in early phase, the increased catecholamine surge resulting in tachycardia, hypertension, increased central venous pressures, hyperglycemia, increased cerebral blood flow, lactic acidosis, which can result from the continuous rigorous muscle activity. Initially, there is mild hypoxemia and modest hypercarbia, and other autonomic instabilities include diaphoresis and hypersecretion. Whereas in late phase, there's marked hypothermia, hypotension, and hypoglycemia, and the cerebral autoregulation is lost. There is cerebral edema, which is more predominant in pediatric population as compared to the adult, and there is rhabdomyolysis, hyperkalemia, and the marked hypoxia and hypercarbia. And patient may present with apnea, and there is poor handling of the secretion, can result in respiratory compromise. Pupillary and corneal reflexes may be absent, and patient may have mydriasis. Rarely, a patient may develop DIC and multi-organ dysfunctioning either by the status itself or by the inciting causes. Myoglobinuria and dehydration and a shock-like state may lead towards the renal failure. Hepatic insufficiency may result either from the side effects of the anticonvulsant therapy or from the hyperparexia. So these are the laboratory investigations that we can perform. They include serum glucose level, calcium, magnesium electrolytes, LFTs, levels of the anti-epileptic medication if the patient is already taking some anti-epileptics, complete blood counts to see any infective etiology, cultures in case of any infective etiology, and etc. So neuroimaging brain CT can be performed to evaluate for any acute bleed or cerebral edema. And MRI brain can be performed to see any structural pathologies, EEG to see the status of the seizures, and CSF count if you are suspecting any meningitis encephalitis. So every minute delay between the onset of treatment and emergency room arrival, there's a 5% cumulative risk, increasing the risk of having a status lasting more than 30 minutes. So the aim should be the prompt and goal-directed therapy. Key components of status management include the initial stabilization, including the respiratory and cardiovascular support, pharmacological therapy for seizure termination, neuroprotective measure, and the evaluation and treatment of the underlying cause. So positioning, in initial stabilization, positioning is very important so that you can prevent the child from the risk of aspiration. Supplemental oxygen should be done and other respiratory supports. If the patient needs ventilator support or any other measures, it should be initiated as early as possible. Hypotension should be treated with isotonic fluids and hypoglycemia should be corrected promptly, and electrolyte abnormalities, especially hyponatremia and hypocalcemia, should be corrected promptly. So other medication include thiamine if you're suspecting any nutritional deficiencies. If the child is already at the risk of nutritional deficiencies, then you can consider thiamine. Pyridoxine you can give to neonates with persistent seizures and suspected pyridoxine-dependent seizure activity. So intubation is indicated. Usually the rapid sequence tracheal intubation should be considered for the airway protection and respiratory supports in patients with hypoxemia, hypoventilation, weakened airway protective reflexes with the the GCS of less than 8. If neuromuscular blockade is necessary to facilitate the intubation, then a short acting agent allow more rapid evaluation of continuous seizure activity. It should also be keep in mind the risk of hyperkalemia is associated with ongoing seizures, and the activity should be considered if using succinylcholine. So the progression of treatment include administration of the first line agent, then you can proceed towards the second line agent. If the seizures are not controlled, then you can progress towards the pharmacologic coma for the treatment of refractory status epilepticus. So administration of anticonvulsant for the status should proceed along a defined timeline with the goal of controlling status within 30 minutes of progression. If the child is already on anti-epileptic drugs, then administer that drug before using any other medication. Mm-hmm. And also involve the cardiac, the pediatric neurology and PICU team. So these are the first line medication for generalized convulsive status epilepticus, focal motor seizures, myoclonic status epilepticus. You can give lorazepam or benzodiazepine. For neonatal status, you can choose phenobarb as a first line agent. And second line agents include fosphenytoin and valproate or lorazepam. For non-convulsive status epilepticus, again, the benzodiazepine comes as a first-line agent, and for absence seizure, second-line agent, valproic acid can be given, and for complex partial seizure, fosphenytoin or phenytoin are preferable, and non-convulsive status epilepticus, fosphenytoin or the pharmacologic coma can be initiated. So benzodiazepine include lorazepam, diazepam, and midazolam, and it binds the GABA receptor complex and facilitate the GABA action. The peak effect of IV lorazepam usually occur 15 minutes after dosing, and duration is usually 3 to 6 hours. Both diazepam and midazolam have shorter duration than lorazepam, 15 minutes and 30 to 80 minutes respectively. Barbiturate, that phenobarb is most commonly used barbiturate and first line agent, considered as a first line agent in neonatal status, and a second line agent for the rest of the status. And it also acts by enhancing the GABA activity, onset of action 5 minutes, peak level usually achieved in 15 minutes, and dose adjustment may be required in case of renal or hepatic insufficiency. So this is the basic algorithm that we should follow. If the child present to you within 5 minutes and location is pre-hospital, then try to support the airway breathing circulation and consider benzodiazepine, either rectal, buccal, or intranasal route, and try to obtain the IV access. If a child present to you at 5 to 10 minutes in the emergency department, consider the other measures as well. Check glucose level, biochemistry, correct electrolytes, and consider at 10 to 15 minutes, consider intubation if there is evidence of inadequate airway protection or hypoventilation or hypoxia, and also consider appropriate diagnostic testing at this point in time. You can repeat IV dose of first line agent or and consider second line agent and optimize the second line agent if seizure persists. Then at 25 to 30 minutes, the plan should be that the child should be shifted to PICU, and continuous EEG monitoring should be considered. And at more than 30 minutes, that means the status is refractory, consider to provide vasopressor support and provide central venous pressure monitoring and arterial line monitoring, and consider pharmacologic coma. So this is the recommended dosing and serious adverse effect of all the medications of antiepileptics. The first three is basically the first line agent. The rest are the second, considered as the second line agents. So for refractory status epilepticus, pharmacologic coma is typically achieved using benzodiazepine and barbiturate guided by the continuous EEG monitoring. Continue pharmacologic coma for 24 to 48 hours after seizure control. Tapering of coma medications typically occur over 24 hours, but may be more gradual. And the endpoint of pharmacologic coma may be either seizure cessation or bus suppression pattern. So prior to tapering the medication, therapeutic levels of maintenance anticonvulsant medication should be assured. So in pharmacologic coma, you can use midazolam coma. The bolus dose is basically 0.2 mg per kg. And you can start the infusion at 1 to 2 mics per kg per minute, increase every 15 minutes to 2 to 4 mics per kg till clinically or electrical seizures control or the burst suppression pattern appear on the EEG recording. The maximum dose, you can go around 25 to 27 mics per kg per minute. And you can continue for 24 hours till the last seizures abort. And continue all the maintenance drugs to achieve the steady levels. Another drug is ketamine. Ketamine is a non-competitive NMDA receptor antagonist and is neuroprotective in experimental status epilepticus model. And it's actually the preserved. It's actually preserved during the ongoing and prolonged seizures. And typically has been added after prolonged status and usually reserved for especially when there's other medications fail to remit status. Other options include thiopental, propofol, isoflurane, and the additional treatment options include when the drugs high doses suppressive therapy is associated with high morbidity and mortality. Most children are not the surgical candidates for hemispherectomy. However, the cerebral lobar resection or hemispherectomy can be considered in patients with discrete localized seizure foci. Additional non-surgical therapy for refractory status include electroconvulsive therapy, immune modulation, or ketogenic diet. These are the neuroprotective measures that we should done in all the patients with brain injury, either traumatic or non-traumatic. The target saturation should be 94 to 99%. Keep the patient euvolemic, euglycemic, euthermia should be maintained, and systemic blood pressure should be targeted to 92-95th centile. And head should be in the midline position. So the key point in the management of status include the goal in the management of status is basically the termination of the seizure as early as possible to achieve the best outcome. The latest treatment algorithm all focus on moving through the treatment options in a timely manner to achieve the seizure cessation. From treatment with benzodiazepine in the first line of treatment for all the status epilepticus, but patient may require some other additional medication. In case of refractory status epilepticus coma, coma-inducing medication should be initiated as early as possible to terminate the status epilepticus. Thank you.